For his own thoughts on the issue, we are joined by Attorney Christian Monsod, one of the framers of the 1987 Constitution. Good morning, Attorney Monsod. Welcome back to the program. Kindly unmute, sir. Good morning. Attorney Monsod, good morning.
Yes, good morning.
Sir, let me begin. Let's do some fact-checking here. Let me begin by getting your reaction first to former Senate President and now Chief Presidential Legal Counsel Juan Ponce Enrile's statement to the Senate yesterday, justifying the imposition of martial law, supposedly due to the threat of communist insurgency. How much of a threat was communist insurgency at that time to justify what he said they did? Closing the entire country, controlling communication lines, sequestering TV stations, imposing curfew, asking the people to surrender their weapons. Was that justified?
Well, actually, martial law was declared by Marcos in order to stay in power because his term was ending and there's a prohibition beyond 8 years. So, at saka yung sinasabi nila na in order to get stability, the opposite was what happened. Mm-hmm. We had stability. Because of the abuse of martial law powers by the president. And that's one of the things that we, yung iniba namin sa 1935 Constitution, yung checks and balances, nilagay din namin dun sa declaration of martial law. And the Supreme Court had a role to play in order to verify or validate yung sufficiency for the basis of martial law, the sufficiency of the basis for declaring martial law. But kasi martial law is an extraordinary power. It should be gagamitin lang yan, yung talagang urgency for the survival of the state. And yung under the 1937 Constitution, walang checks and balance. Kung gusto lang ng presidente, he has absolute right to declare martial law, which he did. And we should learn yung lessons of the past on what happened when you put absolute power in the hands of one person. That cannot happen in a democracy.
Attorney Monsod, can we still trust Chief Presidential Legal Counsel Enrile's account of martial law, given that he has previously provided conflicting accounts? There were news reports in 1986 that he supposedly admitted in a press conference that the alleged ambush was actually staged, only to take it back in a 2012 memoir. So which is which?
I think the truth is it was staged. That's the and alam mo nung in-admit niya yun, kasi hindi ba napaiyak pa nga siya kay Cardinal Sin kasi hihingi siya ng tulong because he was really plotting a coup d'etat against Marcos because parang ang tingin nila nawawala yung power kay Marcos at meron mga ibang people na tao na surrounding the president who will take over. So the question is who will take over martial law? He was not for stopping martial law. He wanted the power of martial law for himself and RAM, the military arm that was with him for a coup d'etat. So, iba yung context eh. Iba yung context noon at saka ngayon. And I think hindi totoo na we are denying in the 1987 Constitution that we are denying the extraordinary powers of the president in case of emergency of invasion or rebellion. In yung imminent danger thereof at saka lawless violence. Because yung interpretation nung imminent danger and lawless violence is an issue by itself.
Really. We will get to that in a bit, Attorney Monsod, the detailed discussion and the provisions. But before we get to that, I just want to get your reaction also on that exchange between Senator Robin Padilla and Enrile. Senator Padilla said, hindi po nila makita yung wisdom noong pagkakatatag ng martial law noon na nagsagip sa ating kalayaan. Did martial law really save our freedom?
Oh, you mean save?
Save, no. He said, save, sagip.
What martial law is the opposite. It reduced or removed our freedoms because of the absolute powers exercised by the president. Kaya we wanted the checks and balance. Kasi, alam mo, the yung what are the powers of a president under martial law? Mm-hmm. That is mentioned in the constitution because it's an emergency. So that's uncharted territory. So we wanted to make sure that there's also some check and balance in that, in declaring it in the first place. And mm-hmm. that invasion or rebellion, yun ang basis na tinitingnan namin because it threatens na this the sovereignty and integrity of the country.
Mm-hmm. It really is proposing to revert to the 1935 Constitution because he is saying that supposedly it's brief, simple, easy to understand compared to the more complicated 1987 Constitution. And we're talking about the Declaration of Martial Law, for example. He said the solo decision to impose martial law was with the president and the Supreme Court cannot interfere. You did mention earlier that the checks and balances in the 1987 Constitution were put in place precisely to avoid this situation. So why would it be appealing to us now to go back to a situation when there are no checks and balances?
Well, first of all, let's clarify it. The president can proclaim martial law for 60 days mm-hmm. By himself first. Kasi nga, emergency unit. Mm-hmm. And I was the one who put that there. Give him the immediate powers in a real emergency. Pero meron ding participation ang Congress and may participation ang Supreme Court. Kung nakikita nila na mali yung ginawa ng presidente at kailangan na hindi ituloy yun, di ba? Yung that's the provision in the Constitution. It's not true that in an emergency, the president cannot do anything. Mm-hmm. There is room for the president in a real emergency to have martial law, but subject to the Congress and the Supreme Court to see if it were under false assumptions and premises. Mm-hmm. You know, differential now in 1935 Constitution. When yun yung sinasabi niya na dapat ang model yung 1935 Constitution, in a way, I agree with that because it is a presidential unitary system. Uh-huh. Supposed to be checks and balances, kaya lang kulang sa tingin namin. Pero ang big difference between 1935, 1973, and 1987 Constitution is social justice. Uh-huh. Heart of the 1987 Constitution ay yung social justice to address the wrongs of the past, not only during the dictatorship, but even while we were under colonial power, uh-huh. it was the government was controlled by the elite. It was a feudalistic system that we want to change and make it a truly democratic system. Yun ang main one difference, number one. Number two, sa 1987 Constitution, never again, authoritarianism, particularly yung tinatawag na constitutional authoritarianism, where the authoritarianism is allowed by the Constitution, as in the 1935 Constitution. And number three, the economy must be firmly and safely in Filipino hands. Yun ang three main innovations in the 1987 Constitution that were not there in the 1935 Constitution.
Mm-hmm. Attorney Monson, let me just go back to the safeguards put in place by the 1987 Constitution, and one of which is the removal of the phrase imminent danger. And this pertains to lawless violence, invasion, insurrection, or rebellion. These were omitted in the 1987 Constitution so that only the basis for declaring martial law would be invasion and rebellion. Explain to us the nuance of this provision. Why was it necessary to remove the term imminent danger?
Because that's a very, you know, open-ended provision, and what people forget is that under the provision on commander-in-chief of at the president's commander-in-chief, the president has what they call the calling power of the armed forces. Uh-huh. And even in the 1987 Constitution, nandun yung lawless violence. Na that is sufficient na really yung martial law is about the military taking over civilian functions of government because they cannot function anymore because of invasion or rebellion. You know, that's what's important to remember here. Now, it's not as if the president is powerless. That's not true. Calling power of the armed forces ang presidente. That yung solution niya, they don't mention it. But that's also in the 1987 constitution.
What about the removal of the phrase insurrection? Of course, you still have rebellion there. But why did you consider removing that term, insurrection?
Insurrection doesn't really, I think, endanger the sovereignty and territorial integrity of the country. Insurrection is a limited type of, it's a limited rebellion, call it that way. No? And why do you need martial law? You already have the calling powers of the president for lawless violence. And as I said, imminent danger thereof is a very elastic term that can be misused and abused by a president that is greedy for power.
Now, the role of the Supreme Court and Congress after the declaration of martial law, as you said, was added in the 1987 Constitution, supposedly to serve as a check. But realistically, after what we've seen with martial law in Mindanao, can we expect Congress and the Supreme Court to act as a check to the imposition of martial law?
Well, I think we can. And there are instances out in history that the Congress or Supreme Court do not live up to what is expected of them in the Constitution. But that's part of institution building. We learn also from our mistakes. And we have to have faith that in the long run, the institutional provisions of the Constitution, will continue to mature and have and strengthen our institutions rather than weaken it, as in the case of the declaration of martial law by President Duterte, by the Supreme Court, overly deferred to him, yung whether there was a sufficiency of factual basis for martial law. Yung mali yun, yung ginawa ng Supreme Court doon to accommodate the president. And in fact, if you read the Supreme Court decision, sinari pa nila nung martial law helped in the rehabilitation of the areas, in the economic development. Those are the basis for martial law. E dinagdag ng Supreme Court yun na they were saying, well, it also helped here and that. In the oral arguments in the Supreme Court, the chief of staff then, si General Guerrero, was asked by the Supreme Court, was martial law necessary for you to address the Marawi incident, rebellion, or what you call it? And sabi ni General Guerrero, no, it was not necessary. But sabi niya, it was helpful to us that yung agencies of government gave 100% support for what we were doing, which is laughable, right, for him to say that and say that it helped the executive agencies to help them. Executive agencies are under the control of the president. There was poor governance by the president. That's when you have the problems of the executive officers not, you know, pulling or putting their 100% effort and powers to help in the rehabilitation, to help on the economy, and so on and so forth. You don't need martial law for that. A weak president needs martial law for that. And he should not be president in the first place.
What do you make of Enrile's proposal to expand the number of senators from 24 to 48, citing the increase in population? And he also advocates for the holding of elections of 16 senators every 2 years. As a former COMELEC chairman yourself, what would be the repercussions of this suggestion?
Well, it's just that during the Constitutional Commission, we wanted to reduce the number of elections. So instead of every 2 years, every 3 years, but increasing the number of senators, I think we should think about that. As we should also think about amendment para yung voting for president and vice president in tandem. then sort of there didn't come from different parties. But this can be done by amendment. Kaya nga sa ang advice sa atin yung conference dito in 2017 is that when you have a functioning democracy, no matter how imperfect it is, you should refine and amend rather than overhaul.
Mm-hmm.
Because it doesn't happen. You know, people don't do that because they know that it's a very dangerous move with a lot of unforeseen consequences. And why are we going to take a chance on that when mm-hmm. we define and amend and not overall change in the constitution? You know, mm-hmm. advice natin ng experts in 2017.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, as a result of that statement of former Senator Enrile yesterday, the question now among a lot of people is the 1935 Constitution really better than the 1987 Constitution? And is it even time to talk about charter change?
Well, alam nyo, ask the poor. Mm-hmm. Ask the poor whether they want to go back to 1935 or whether they want the 1987 Constitution, because and then the poor are the center of development with social justice, not just in Article 13, but even in other provisions of the Constitution, even in the provision on the economy, right? That was the central theme of the 1987 Constitution. You ask the poor if they want to eliminate all of those provisions on social justice that are for them, that from 1987 we should have had. We should put the poorest center of our development. And every administration since EDSA has failed to fulfill that promise of a new social order.
Mm-hmm. And that, thank you. Mm-hmm.
Don't change the constitution, implement the constitution.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Attorney Christian Monsod, one of the framers of the 1987 Constitution and a former COMELEC chairman.
Can I just make one last comment?
Sure. Go ahead, sir.
Mr. Enrile, or Chief Legal Counsel Enrile, says make 1935 the model. That means he is not supporting a shift to a federal parliamentary system. What does Senator Padilla think of that?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We will try to ask Senator Padilla about that point. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Attorney Christian Monsod.
You're welcome.